Without it, now you start scrambling with the family. Is it the brother? Is it, you know, all that discussion that you don't want with whatever property. Whether it's a car, people kill themselves over a car. You know that? You will find your two sisters and brothers just fighting one another. So please, leave a will, especially for the business. Now we're talking business. I'm not talking only about your private property, but the business. Is it dying with you? Is that what you want? If you haven't made a will. Okay? The lawyer's right here to tell you how to make the will, and I'm sure she'll be very happy to do that if that's something you want to know, if you haven't done it. It's very simple. Okay? So please have a will and save your business so it can continue. Involve your families the other way in your business. Is your husband aware? He may not be a lawyer like you, but is he aware what you're doing? Is he aware what you own? Okay, some husbands are difficult. I understand. You have to manage your life. But the children. We keep our children away from farms. They have no idea what happens on the farm. They have no idea what happens in how you sell. Have you seen Asian children? Have you seen six-year-olds serving you in a shop? That's why they are so successful. But you make sure you keep your child in the playground while you do business. So let's involve the family so that right from the word go, they begin to understand how to do business, because that's the only way forward. Not many people get jobs. Even your children will have that problem. But if they grew up already entrepreneurial, because their mother, their father was entrepreneurial, then you have an advantage. I think I will stop there, Madam MCs. Thank you very much for listening to me.
Thank you very much, Dr. Maggie Chigozi. A harder and stronger round of applause for her. I picked one thing or two, but most importantly, the will. Very important. This is something that we really overlook. And then we start asking, but yeah, I have three handbags, two high heels. Those ones my sister will take, but I think it's something we need to take seriously, because it has happened in our family or even extended families where someone passes away and it is a tug of war. One thing she also said is we should never miss an opportunity to learn, because you never know where and how that knowledge will help you as you go along. Then she advised us to build our capacity in any way possible, because really, if you're aiming to reach at the top, you have to be prepared. And most of all, they say knowledge is power. It's really true, because it's an area you need to go, you are going to go in, and you will need a lot of knowledge to be able to maneuver through. Then find your passion. At the end of the day, I think most of us is an age you reach where you don't want, it's not about the money, but it is something that gives you excitement when you wake up every morning. That even when you sleep at 3, Michael MC, Shirley slept at 3 a.m. And she told me one thing today morning. Honestly, I would not be anywhere else. Imagine she slept at 3. But she still woke up at 6, and she's passionately saying how she's not what? She doesn't want to be anywhere else apart from where she is right now. So passion, very important. Then take advantage of opportunities, either through volunteering or through paid up services. For most of us who volunteer, sometimes we think it's a CSR, but it helps you build on a lot of things and helps you understand an industry you would not have, because I will be very honest with you, sometimes even classroom does not prepare you for what is out here. But it's only through volunteering and being sitting with experts that they're able to even give you tricks on how to do what? How to perform in a particular role. So she advised us to volunteer. That is something I have also taken up. Then there's also an opportunity to travel to Liverpool. She mentioned it. So maybe if you can get in touch with her and she gives you more information, because at the end of the day, our theme talks about harnessing global trade opportunities to empower the African woman. And this is really a global opportunity that I don't think most of us would want to miss. So I'll invite my co-MC, Shirley, to take up the second session. But before that, the area of convenience, take your left, go down the first steps, and take your left again. That's where our restrooms are. Then there'll be water outside, but I think we'll first have the first panelist session, then we can do a short break. Then another thing, we have exhibitors just at the back of the hall. I think one of the things that we talked about is empowering. We're here to empower women. And one of the things that is included in empowering will be to support other women's businesses. So there are ladies at the back who are doing an exhibition. So it would be nice to pass by the stalls, see what they do. And most importantly, supporting in Luganda is buying the products. See, Checho? Yes. So let us support them by viewing and buying as well. So Shirley, please come and take over.
Thank you, Jennifer. How are you all? I see we've gotten a bit more audience. So I like to start off my sessions with a bit of activity, because for most of the dialogues that I run, we come in, we sit down, we do nothing. So I'm giving out an iPhone S, gold colored. Who wants it? Okay, I see she knows this game. Bye. Okay, so the essence of that is to say, if you want something, go out and get it. So we'll have a panel session, and our moderator, as she makes her way to the stage, is Amelia Martha Nachitimbo. I think one of my dreams as a child was to be a journalist. Slowly, somehow, that went away. I got to school and decided I wanted to do math instead of history, so somewhere along the way, math communication became a dream. I can still join? That's why I do this sometimes. So Amelia is a broadcast journalist working with Vision Group and a news anchor and reporter for Urban TV and 94.8 FM. I hope I've given justice to your profile. We usually don't want to take away from our audience, so I'd like to invite the other members of the panel to join. Dr. Maggie Chigozi. Ruth Sebatindira from Legal Mark Advocate. Manuela Mlondo. Esther Zamulia Gonja. And Brenda Oppas. So this discussion is going to be centered around harnessing opportunities for women's economic and social development. I think we're missing one panel member. As we make our way to the stage, I'll just give Amelia.
Missing a She said, my name is Amelia Martha Nashtimbo, and I work with Urban TV and XFM as a broadcast journalist. And I'll give a chance to our panelists introduce themselves. I don't think Dr. Maggie will be introducing because she has just given us a keynote.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I think it's exciting that we have men in the room as well. We shouldn't be speaking just to ourselves. My name is Ruth Sebatindra. I work with Legal Mark Advocates. I'm a lawyer, essentially a commercial lawyer, and this is my 20th year in practice. My law firm, this is the 15th year of our operation. So I'm excited to be here. When I heard that young women were asking me to come to speak to them, I couldn't miss this chance. When you are at my age, I'm 44, and young people are looking for you, you kind of get a spring in your gait. So thank you for making me feel younger this morning.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Esse Zambia Gonja. I am a communication and business coach at Audacious Consulting, a firm that I founded only about a year ago. It's a firm that I'd been thinking about a whole lot, the whole of the past 2 years. So when I came to the summit last year in September, I found the Uganda Registration Services Bureau table at the back. And I said, this is my cue to formalize this whole thing. So I did. And I am on my way to building my consulting firm in communication and business coaching. But I also run a small enterprise providing women's clothing and fashion accessories. It's called Anatoth Clothing. And it's something that I really love to do. But I have taken a lot of inspiration and a lot of support from Zimba. So I'm glad to be here. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Actually, the most exciting thing is to know that we already have testimonies about the Zimba Women's Summit, one from last year, and she has just given us her testimony. So this is not just talk. Here we are going to have solutions and, solutions to what we have. Manuela, just... Welcome, Manuela. You just found us introducing ourselves, and I'll give you a chance to introduce yourself to those who may not know you in our audience.
Thank you so much. Hello, how are you doing? Manuela Pachito Mulondo is my name, and I'd like to apologize for being late. I got a few issues on the way, but I'm here, and I'm glad to be here. I'm actually excited to be here. Because one of the things that I believe in is women empowering each other. And that is how I started The Credo. I'm the CEO and founder of The Credo. The Credo is a 24-hour childcare center designed for the workplace. And ideally what we do is set up childcare centers at organizations to allow mothers have a place where they can continue to have a relationship with their children and yet also be the career women that they would love to be. I felt that this started when I just had my first child, and I happened to look around for a place where I could leave my child without having to worry. And I felt that every daycare center I went to was attached to a kindergarten, and they were not necessarily taking care of a child the way I would have thought they should. I wanted to be informed about my child's brain development. I wanted my child to be stimulated. I just didn't want them to be showered, fed, they play, they sleep. Showered, fed, they play, they sleep. Like, I was just like, no, I was not for that clockwork. I wanted to be able to speak to someone who could tell me about what my child's development is looking like, what their goals are, what they should be like. And none of the daycare centers was doing that for me. So I thought, and then I'm like, okay, why don't we just start something that can work for women and place where mothers can know their child is being raised, not just being taken care of, but their child is being raised. And so that's how I started The Credo, and it's growing. We're actually moving to our new premises, which will hold about 60 to 80 babies, and so we're really excited for that. And that means we can have we can help more mothers. Up till now we've worked with about 200 mothers, And we work with children from newborn to 4 years old. Many people ask me why we start with newborn. We've had cases where mothers have died having babies and fathers had no idea where to take the children. And so that's what we do. We also work 24 hours because we have mothers who have to go up country, who have to go out of the country or have to work in call centers, yes. And so we also established it to be 24 hours so that we can allow that, but also to allow for families to grow. If a husband would like to take his wife really for a weekend away, why not? Yeah, we don't want fathers complaining that when the children came, then they were forgotten, and then, my God, I don't know what happened to my wife. She became a goo-goo gaga. She never talks to me. So that's why we did that. But yeah, that's who I am, and that's what I do.
Thank you very much. I picked something from what she said. It's about passion, and that rhymes with what Dr. Maggie had spoken about earlier, about what's that thing that makes you angry? What are you passionate about? And then you follow it. Now, one of our panelists had also followed her passion, but like 1 year later, she kind of put the passion aside and chased her profession. Would you like to tell us more about that?
Well, I think that I'm passionate about both. I quit my job in 2012 when I was tired, and I started the small enterprise, Anatoth Clothing, because I love beautiful clothes. So I did that for 3 years, and I got the experience building a business. It wasn't easy at first, but I discovered that when you are resilient, you can actually grow a business. Now it's at a place where I'm so comfortable that I am able to focus on my consulting firm, returning to the professional side of me. I am a communication and business professional. So I spent the whole of my work life doing communication work with international organizations. And then of course that came to an end when I just felt exhausted. So now I am at a place where I am rediscovering the professional side of me after being away for the past 3 years. But I want to say that I'm passionate about both. I am so passionate about seeing businesses actually grow. And I believe that the experience that I've had building my small enterprise is useful for people that are starting out. But I want to say that you need to be passionate. There is just no way you can get away from it. I discovered that when times are really hard, your passion drives you always. Yeah.
Okay, we have Ruth Sewatindra here with us. And like Dr. Maggie had referred to her many times, there's that legal aspect that we want to know. I'm very curious. Most of my friends who have gone to law school, when they finish school, maybe the aspiration will be get employed somewhere. And according to the chat we had earlier today, you told me you looked around and you did not see very many females in firms or leading. How can we empower a young woman, for instance, to start up her own firm or be a leader in a firm that she joins? You can share that according to the experience you had before.
Thank you, Amelia. I think my experience would pretty much speak to your experiences if you've not had them already. It's difficult seeing women leading in the operation, in the organizations in which we work. Maybe majority of our women are mid-level managers, but do we have women in the boardrooms? Do we have women leading your teams? And I think that's a critical question. But briefly sharing my story, when I worked for a law firm for nearly 5 years and then went off to Deloitte & Touche and did a stint as a tax advisor there. But while I was there, many times the reception would kind of fill with people looking for me from the law firm that I had worked for. So I would go back home and I tell my husband, can you imagine I had to now keep referring these clients to friends to tell them, you know, now I'm in Deloitte & Touche, I'm doing tax advisory, so I can't do litigation because I was a litigator.
So my husband tells me, I think God is telling you something. Maybe you should, start a law firm. And I thought he was out of his mind. I hadn't really thought about starting a law firm back then. I was as young as you, and it's beautiful that you're here and as business owners, but I wasn't thinking like you then. So, okay, long story short, I turn up one evening, I told my husband, okay, I acted on your advice, I've resigned. He said, no, I didn't mean you do it immediately, because I had worked for Deloitte, I think, nearly 6 months. So I said, no, you ought to have stayed in that job for about 2 years, then get experience, people get to know you. Anyway, so I think that madness needs to kick in, when that moment comes and you just get up and go. And just start whatever is on your head and start it. So with my madness, then I started the law firm. We are called Legal Mark Advocates. And it wasn't easy starting because I looked for role models. I looked for mentors. I looked for women that owned a law firm that I really was, I would die to look like. So, but then, I go to a woman who tells me, a female lawyer who had just started her firm, who tells me her things are going to be tight. Now, for the first 6 months, you look for a client, you won't get any, rent will be hard. So you go buy a sofa, you'll be sleeping there as you're waiting for clients. So I go home, I didn't have cash, I tell my husband, now, I need a sofa to be sleeping in. So that's what I think. We joke a lot about that sofa. So, poor guy buys the sofa, we put it in. Now I sit waiting for clients in the hope that when I get tired, I will be sleeping. But then again, you get those moments when you question. You question yourself and say, okay, why did I set up this thing? Why, it can't be that I set up to sit here to sleep. Yeah? I set up the law firm, it was on the fifth floor of King Fahd Plaza on Kampala Road. So who would be walking on the street to look for me on fifth floor on King Fahd? No one really, isn't it? So one Saturday, because I used to work Monday to Sunday, there were no offs for me. You are sole proprietor, you are the accountant, you are the lawyer, you are everything. So one day I was sitting there, pondering. It's as if my mom tells me, what is that chair for? What, just get rid of it. And I think that little voice then helped me, so I got rid of the sofa. I never sat in it, and then started hitting the streets. I did a profile, knocked on doors, went to in-house lawyers that were my classmates, and started now pitching. I was a hunter, and now I'm older. I don't hunt as much, as I was then, but people who knew me when I was starting were saying, my God, Ruth, what's happening to you, I was in survival mode. I had to survive. So that's the story.
What do you think you wish you knew before setting out on your own at that point? Now that you look back some 15 years later, what do you wish you knew then or you had been equipped with?
I wish I had known about things like strategy. How do you think strategically? Business acumen. How do you develop your business acumen? How do you build networks? Financials. I mean, in law school, and lawyers, we freak out when it comes to numbers. That's a fact. The only numbers we are familiar with are the fee notes that we give you. Pay. After that, the financials play us a lot. So, but then I was also very lucky. 2 months, I think, into starting, I get a friend who tells me there is Enterprise Uganda, and they can. Back then, I think it was U.S. Embassy which was funding 40 participants. So I enrolled for this program. That's when I was lucky, I must say. 2 months into starting, I learned about customer care, marketing, financials, business planning, all these things. As a lawyer, you don't know them. And definitely as a doctor or any other professional, I think most of you are ICT professionals. So these are things we need to quickly learn, strategy, business, financials, marketing. Marketing for me and branding then became my third language after litigation and rights. But marketing, I think, is one of those things that we really need to work on and financials. So, in fact, the thing then I would say, I think out of this meeting, Zimba Women, I hope we can get a platform where maybe we synergize with entities like Enterprise Uganda and just teach women in terms of strategic thinking. What is your strategy? you're an ICT, you're a professional. What, and we are all in the same room, we're all going to be fighting for the same clients. Why would we be coming to you and not the next person? So those are things to think about.
Yeah, one of the reasons why we're at this summit is to network. Thank you. I thank the MCs for asking us to turn to our neighbors earlier on when we had started, for those who came early, and ask your neighbor what is it that they are doing, because networking is very important. Now, this is a question I'm going to throw to all the panelists, the other panelists. Is there such a thing as over-networking? And then, I like that. And then, how would you, what tips would you give, for instance, to a young businesswoman who maybe all they know is the contacts they've made on social media, or they do not even know how to talk to someone? They may see Dr. Maggie right here. They know that she may have all the people maybe that they need, the contacts, the tips, but they just do not know how to approach you, or the questions to ask you when they approach you to bring about that connection.
I will start with the sharing by Ruth that she left her job and started her business. I don't know if I spent enough time on that. Whatever you do, do not do that. You need to eat, you need to sleep as you had, and a new business will not make money for a while. So if you can possibly still continue working while doing your business, you can start. All right? So that was a terrible move.
It turned out all right.
Yes, you did turn out all right, and that's fantastic. Thrown in at the deep end. On the over-networking. Is that possible? Yes, actually some of us just love to network, and that's it. You network because you love people. You're a happy person. I'm a very happy person. You're a happy person by nature. You love to meet people. So yes, you can do your networking, which doesn't help your business. Yeah? So make sure you are focused. What it is you want to achieve for your business. Do the other one because you enjoy it. But and you never know. Some of those people that you just meet, by the way, actually end up being very, very useful. But you can try to be more focused as to who you meet, who's likely to buy from you, who's likely to sell to you, who's likely to build your capacity. There's no reason why you would not look at Zimba women as a star opportunity that you have fallen into and really stick with them. Yeah? But there are others that might be social media. Unfortunately, we do gossip a lot on social media. It is gossip, and gossip is the one thing I have to say to you, even on social media, is a no-no. People don't forget. You abused me last time. Now you are in my office asking me for something. I know you were on social media. Yes, but I know you. So be careful. Be careful. Whatever you're saying.
And I'd love to hear from SSL Steel on networking. What tips can you give to young women entrepreneurs on how to build their networks? Your tips.
One of the things that Dr. Maggie Kigozi hinted on was that we need to be careful about the things that we say on social media. We need to remember that everything that we write is archived, and that at some point it will come back to haunt you. Especially if you said something really terrible about someone, you don't want those things to come back. So you need to be very careful what you're saying and where you're saying it. You cannot be over-networked. I think that life is really about people. And if they have nothing to bring to your business, you most definitely have something that you can give to them. The philosophy is that givers gain. So what is it that you have in your hand that you can give to someone else that will improve their life? That is a very critical thing for us to think about. But then the other thing is that we need to be very deliberate. I am on social media quite a lot, and I look at people's profiles a whole lot, and I am very careful what I put there, because I am focusing on presenting a certain image to the public. I need to be very careful. So when you are out there, you need to know who you really want to be perceived as. And that therefore means that you need to be very strategic about the things that you say, about the way that you look, about the places that you even go. Because if you're looking to build relationships that are based on trust, really, business is about relationships that are based on trust. You need to be a trustworthy person. So you need to be very careful about those things that I just mentioned.
Okay, thank you, Isaza. So we have followed our passion, created the Credo, created LegalMark Advocates, and Audacious Consultants. And we have now known how to create networks. But then how can we bridge the gap? Because we are looking at economic and social development for women. How do we connect the gap to ensure that we like creating more networks for women to ensure, to ensure that more women are brought on board? Earlier in a conversation we had, you mentioned that, for instance, some young women, some young lawyers may not know how to or have a ceiling when it comes to being in businesses or entrepreneurships. So now that we are there, how can we bring more people? And even those that are there, how can we mentor them or guide them to ensure that those gaps that are there are bridged? I hope I make myself clear.
Okay, bridging the gap. For a start, I think that we need to create the spaces for these women to engage one another. I think it's about coming to a place where you can actually have a conversation. You cannot build a business all by yourself because you don't know what to do. When I first started out running my small enterprise, my clothing boutique, I found that I wished I knew about taxes, for instance. My first year of business, I had 2.8 million shillings worth of penalties from URA. And looking back now, I realize that that shouldn't have happened in the first place. If only I had had someone that had showed me the ropes, really, about managing my taxes. So there's got to be a platform, a place like this where people actually meet up and talk, you know, have conversations face to face, be able to ask the questions and get answers. So this is a good place for us to start. But then the question is, how do we take it on from here? There's got to still be that platform. Maybe we want to create a knowledge hub. Maybe we just want to have a regular fellowship. Maybe we just want to have a group on social media that talks about the issues, where people are free to express themselves, they ask the hard questions, and there is someone that is deliberately answering those questions. We can do that.
Thank you. I think one of the ways, and she said it, being in the same room and sharing experiences and agreeing on, you know, what the action plan is one of those very good things. I'll tell you, following up on the fact that I hardly had any female mentors within the legal profession, I then asked the Uganda Law Society that, why don't we create a special chapter for women lawyers? Because women lawyers had kind of disappeared within the legal fraternity. As a litigator, I knew it would either, you know, the women in the courts would be me, maybe Deepa, now Justice Basaza, a handful of us, we knew each other. And so I go to the Law Society to say, why don't we get the women interested back into the profession? Because as you know, I don't know whether you experience it in your profession, when you become pregnant in my profession, it's a sin, you know. You're going to go off, and is it 90 days, they are paying you maternity leave, you know. It used to be viewed as a loss-making, you know, venture. When you employed a woman lawyer that would become pregnant. In fact, when one of the gentlemen I applied a job at told me, Ruth, I already have a woman in my law firm and one is already too many, you know. Yeah. So for us, those were the issues in our industry. So I asked Law Society to give us this platform for us to address these issues. And now we actually have in the training calendar every year, the Women Lawyers chapter will have a conference every February to talk about these issues. How do we hire, retain, and motivate women within the legal legal profession. And the conversation is ongoing. Initially, the men thought, you know, I was crazy. I said, no, no, you take your things to FIDA. I said, no, no, no. FIDA is doing a great job for women and children around the country, but no one is looking out for me as a woman lawyer. How do I thrive like you, the men, within the legal profession? So these conversations should be started in our spaces, wherever we are. Is it in our organizations? Do we have mentorship programs in our organizations? You know, who is sitting at your feet as a woman leader in your organization? It doesn't have to be out of your organization. You can actually start a mentorship program within your own organization. And even then, I seek mentors. So even you as a woman leader, you may still need, you know, to be mentored in some respects. I want to chair a serious board one day in this country. So I've looked for two people that I respect in that space, and I'm learning, you know, I'm on this journey. So mentorship is critical. These conversations are critical to, you know, to engage each other, but most importantly, to engage the men. Men are majority of the employers of our women in the market. So the conversation should engage the men, for them, their mindsets to be opened up, and, you know, to encourage as many women to lead in the organizations in which they work. When I was back in the day, when I was starting, there used to be a British Council Management Forum, I think. I don't know whether it's still there. It used to be in this very hall, I think last Friday of every month or something. God, I would print business cards and come to this hall and just do it. I think I was over networking. I was over networking until one time there was a friend of mine with whom we were over doing this thing. So she was in telcos, I think. So one time he said, no, we are not taking cards anymore. We are okay, because you look in the room and you had been giving your cards. I think over networking, you know, there is an issue there. You can't overdo it. Sometimes you just sit back and just be very interested in the next person seated next to you. In fact, nowadays I don't really give out cards. I just inquire about it. I say, so how are you doing? What are you doing? What are you up to? That interest in the next person. I hope you have actually asked. Oh, in fact, they asked us to ask, so we already did it. But I think that is now to speak into the point you made. When you show interest in the other person, I think it brings better results than now saying, I'm here, legal mark, we buy, we sell. I think that's too much. But I think now being interested in the other person is a better approach.
Yeah, that's well said. It's not over networking, it's making connections that matter, like she said.
We need to talk about childcare centers for lawyers. No more. They shouldn't think of us as serious. This, we, to be honest, none of us chose to be a woman. None of us went out to God and said, hey, you see me? If you give me eggs and ovaries, I can do a good job. No. We just came out and we were women. We didn't book, we didn't choose, but God chose us for that responsibility. So, in my opinion, I shouldn't lose out on anything in life just because I have eggs and an ovary. But moving along to what to what she said about how we can get more women into businesses and things. I'm Christian, and this is how I see our lives. Many times as business owners, we are extremely, and I'm going to say it, selfish. You people are the worst. You're bad. When someone tells you they would like to start a foundation that's similar to yours, you look 180 and run. Yeah? Like, you don't want to help. You don't want to take phone calls. You don't want to reply emails. You want to be the only one who gains. There's no difference between you and people who are kwatakori. There's no difference. Because if you were in those positions, all you would be thinking about is yourself. So in my mind, like I was saying, as a Christian, the only way the gospel went out to the world was when Jesus had how many disciples? 12. If you don't have 12 people that you're helping, please, you are bad. Go to bed and, I'm telling you, go sleeping and say, hey, I'm such a bad person. How do I sleep today? And there are 12 people that I could be helping. That's the only way
you reach, you think your business, you're the only one who will eat. How? You understand what I mean? You won't. You don't, the truth is, you cannot serve the entire world with your business. You need 12 other people to help you with that. So stop being selfish. Get your skill. Come to places like here. Maybe I shall get one disciple. I don't know. Yeah. Come to places like here and share your struggles, share your victories, share what you know, share what you didn't know, share what you think you should have known. Talk to people, help other women. We cannot help other women when we are there in our beds. We're the only ones who eat, we're the only ones who buy, who drive, I don't know which car. You are a bad person, okay? You're a bad, yeah.
Actually, if I may add to what Manuela has just said, there was an expo some time back, which I went and attended, and I was just asking the exhibitors why they were there, or where else they had advertised, because the reason why you go to an expo is you want people to know about your business, more people. And I got very interesting answers. And one of the people answered, I asked, do you advertise, or where else are you advertising or publicizing your business? And they said, I don't want to publicize. People will copy my idea and implement it. And I thought, so what happens when another person comes up with the exact same idea and over-publicizes it? Everyone will think you copied the other person, right? And that is quite very sad. Now,
to just confirm what you've said, when I helped with the Women Lawyers Committee at the Uganda Law Society, I served as its first chair 2 years, you know, run around and did that stuff. So after 2 years, the position of president became vacant. And now the women are saying, now it's our turn to eat this thing. It was the women that we had these conversations with, the women that, you know, we struggled together to help set up law firms or whichever challenges they had, that were really campaigning for me. So it's true that you get out of this whole thing of helping one another. I had a campaign team of women that were just going now door to door to law firms to, you know, to market me, to campaign for me, to tell the other lawyers that this is our president. And I think that speaks to exactly what you've said. Thanks.
I remember writing an article once for Zimba when that other month when we had the theme on breaking barriers, and I mentioned that it's very unfortunate that growing up, you know, getting into the workplace and you have all these women as your bosses and they don't really care for you, they don't care to see that you're better, they don't trust you to do well, they are afraid that you will outshine them. I think that those are some of the attitudes that we need to get rid of. We need to deliberately take other people by the hand. Unleashing potential is really the word that is so commonly used. Deliberately, I think that it's got to be deliberate. You can't just sit at your desk and say, okay, I am a business owner and I've built a business and I'm growing a business. I think you need to deliberately look out for that person that needs your help, very deliberately. So I'm learning that as I do that, I'm getting all these requests coming to me about people who just want to talk, you know? They just want to talk. And what do I have to give? Time. It's about making the time, listening to them, and offering your advice whenever you can. If you're not able to help them, at least you will have gained a friend.
Okay, so you're talking about helping. Stay with that microphone. What advice would you give to a young woman or any woman intending to start up a business today?
One of the things that I have personally learned is that you need to be passionate. If I wasn't, I probably wouldn't be sitting here today. We need to be honest that starting out is always hard. It can be very complicated. But for as long as you are passionate about this thing that you are doing, you'll be able to overcome all the challenges that you are confronted by, because the challenges will come. One of the things that I've always thought about is that we business owners are never honest about how we started out. You know, you go out there and paint this very rosy picture about how you've built this thing and how much you're earning from it and all those things. And then you never really tell them what happened at the beginning. So we need to be honest. Tell them it can be very hard out there, but with the right kind of support, you'll be able to do this thing, whatever it is. So be passionate. Get as much knowledge around the industry as you can, because knowledge is power. Dr. Maggie Chigozi already talked to us about being knowledgeable. When you have the knowledge that you need, you'll be able to confront whatever issues come your way. You'll be able to talk to people, ask them questions. They'll give you the answers that you need. And then, as a result, you'll find that you're growing. Then the other thing is family is important. You need a support system. You most definitely need a support system. If they will give you the money to start the business, they will also be the ones that offer the shoulder that you need to cry on. They will be the ones that will give you food when you don't have any, when you're unable to buy it yourself. You know, they will be the ones that will be there. So it's very important that you have a support network. Very important.
And on the issue of family, I know we tend to have a mindset that when someone, your family member or your friend, is doing a business, then you'll get things for free. If she's selling clothes, you'll get them for free or at a discount or something. But then how about you start a mindset whereby you're the one who even pays more because you're supporting this person? If she has started up a business and she plates hair maybe for 60,000, how about you pay 80,000? To support that business instead of getting it for free because she's your cousin or something.
Let me say something about that. My first client was my son, and he paid. He still pays, and so even when the second baby came, my husband still pays for their childcare at the center.
Shall we clap for that? Yeah, so we'll still hear from the other panelists. What advice would you give to a woman who is starting up a business today?
Okay, this is where we are different, Dr. Maggie and I. Just start. You have to be crazy to just run away.
Just start and don't buy a couch. I hope you don't tell us that.
And I think for me, it's a different world in my mind. And many of the young people who have come to me to ask whether they can start, I think I've always said, start. Just go. Go. Is the idea good? Are you hungry? Do you feel hungry? Do you feel you could die for this thing? Just run. The other things will come. Anyway. But how to start a business? The idea is there. Your creativity is burning. The fire is there in your belly. And of course, then you'll need money. So how are you going to get funding? I think those are critical issues, and that's where I think Dr. Maggie then says go slowly, but the money comes. Anyway, so I think once you have made up your mind that you've started this, you have this idea, you have to create ways of how you become powerful and influential in that field. For me, I think that's my template. Who are you influencing? Influence and power are critical. Who are you influencing? And if you don't know how to become influential in your space, who are you seeking as your mentor to learn how, you know, to get this influence, how to be powerful? Some of us want to be board directors. How will I get a seat at that table without knowing how to, you know, build influence and power? And I think those are the attributes that I think are critical. We learn them a bit later. I learned them later. But I think very early on, if you're sitting right there and you know you want to be the chairperson of your company, which you should be anyway by now, yeah? You are the shareholder, you are the owner of the business, you are the chairman, isn't it? Are you giving cards saying chairman? Yeah? And so if you're that person, you are the head of your table. So, but have you built competences, skills to head that table? Because then that's what you're looking for. That's how you start thinking strategically. You know, where is the economy going? Do you know our country profile? When IMF is launching the Uganda country profile, do we know? Are we aware of the East African market? Are we thinking like that? Your ICT people, you're on Facebook. It's the entire world that you're probably speaking to. So for me, I think strategic thinking, business acumen comes back to those things, business acumen and financials. Women don't grow in their businesses because they stagnate at that level. They don't dream of big figures. Are you going to be a zillionaire? You know, in Uganda, billionaire is now becoming difficult because then you can't convert to dollars. It's just $1 million. So are you going to be a zillionaire? I do have that mindset. And Dr. Maggie again said that we think small as women. Once the children go to school, they finish university. Sit at home. That's not how the men's template is. They are going on to the next project. Richard Branson is in the space. The people he started with, I think, are still in trains. So it's that mentality of how do we think big, and then how do we create ourselves into influential and powerful people in our spaces.
Thank you. And I think one of the things that she mentioned that I find critical is thinking beyond, other than Uganda and East Africa, also knowing about markets in Africa, because Zimba Women Summit is about making connections in the whole of Africa for us, the women who are here. So let's think, let's read, like Dr. Maggie had said. Now I'll skip to Manuela. Still, I'll ask you the same question. What advice would you give to a woman starting business? Then I'll end with Dr. Maggie, who I have just two specific questions for her, and then we shall close this session.
I would say one of my biggest tips is if you're thinking of your business in a certain place, start to act on it now. So if you're thinking you're going to be a zillionaire, start to act like it now. I'll give you an example.